السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Dear colleagues and friends, hope that you are all doing well and fine, and hope that the preparation for the next exam is running in the best way. So today, as I promised you in the group, I'm going to discuss the recall of the postpartum urine retention. Why we are going to discuss this recall? First, as it is one of the recalls, so you can expect it in the exam. Second, because there is a new TOG article which appeared 6 months ago, which was talking about the postpartum voiding difficulties in general, but we will take the part of the postpartum urine retention in today's task. This task, when it appeared in the exam before, it was a structured discussion task, which unusually included assessment of the information gathering, which is unusual in the structured discussion task, plus the usual domains, which are the patient safety, communication with colleagues, and applied clinical knowledge. So when you see that there is information gathering in a structured discussion task, it means you need to ask about more information, or there will be some questions about the history, examination, and investigation. The scenario of the task was that you are the ST5 in the postnatal ward, and your consultant or the examiner is going to discuss with you a case of a lady, she's Bara one now, just delivered by forceps, a big baby, which is 4.2 kg. The lady, she was on epidural, and the urinary catheter was inserted and removed after 6 hours. The woman failed to pass urine. So during the 10 minutes of the task, you are expected to answer the examiner's questions. As usual, I will give you the answers of all the possible questions in such task. So the possible questions in this task usually started by the common question in structured discussion, which is, give me a summary about the case. And the second question will be, what are the additional information you need to know about this patient? This is an emergency situation, so what's your immediate action? And after the immediate action, what is the definition of postpartum urine retention, and what are the risk factors of postpartum voiding difficulty or urine retention, and what are the type of catheter that you are going to use to empty the bladder and relieve her retention, for how long you are going to leave the catheter, and after removal of the catheter and the woman is still having voiding difficulty, what are you going to do, and for how long you are going to keep the catheter? Very important question, whom you are going to involve in her care, who will be included in the multidisciplinary team, and if the cause is hematoma, if you are suspecting or diagnosing hematoma, what will be your management, and what are the possible implications or complications and the symptoms that the woman will likely to suffer in the future. These are all the possible questions that may appear in such task. But my advice for you, don't wait, please, for the examiner to ask. Usually, the examiner will ask the first question, give me a summary about the case, and what will be your management. The point in the communication with colleagues in a structured discussion task, that you will be evaluated about your ability to lead the discussion. So if you have the information, if you know how to go step by step in such task, please lead the discussion and move from one information to the next. Don't wait for the examiner to prompt you to mention a certain information. Leading the discussion during the structured discussion task is one of the very important points in your evaluation regarding your communication with colleagues. Don't make it a question and answer term. What I'm doing now is a teaching session, but in the exam, it is a structured discussion. So if you have the information, if you know the scheme of the answer, go step by step. Don't wait for the examiner to prompt you and the steps of management. So let's go step by step in the answers. The first question will be, give me a summary about the case. Here, there is another advice for you. Please give the summary in your own way. Don't read the candidate instructions, because it is a common habit of the candidates just to read the information written in the candidate brief or the candidate instruction, which is not good in your evaluation in your way of communication. So to make it in the best way, use the SPAR form, the situation, background, assessment, and recommendation. And say it in your own way. Just modify what's written in the candidate brief to say it in your way. What is the situation here? This is a case of postpartum urine retention. What is the background? This is a primary Baras lady who gave birth to a large baby, 4.2 kilogram, which was assisted by forceps delivery, and she was in epidural. What is the assessment? This lady was diagnosed after catheter removal as she failed to pass or to void for 6 hours. So I need more information. Always in the assessment, you will need more information for proper assessment of the lady. What are your recommendations here? This lady needs immediate catheterization to relieve her retention. Then the further action will depend on the amount of drained urine and the amount of residual urine. And also one of the recommendations is to involve your consultant in the management. So this is the best way to answer this question in an organized way, not to miss any point and to impress the examiner. The next question, you don't need to wait for the examiner to ask you what are the additional information you need to know about the patient. Already from the point of assessment here, you told that you need more information. So what are the additional information you need to know about the patient? Again, be organized. Additional information, not only the history. And I mentioned this before. Additional information means history, examination, and investigation. So what are the information you need to know about this patient from the history? You need to know about the 6 Bs, the basic postnatal history. If you remember the 6 Bs, in any postpartum or postnatal lady, the 6 Bs include pain, bleeding, bladder, bowel, breast, and baby. So you have to ask about these 6 Bs in any lady who's in the postnatal period. You have to ask about the first void of urine, the timing, the amount of urine, the color, and if there is associated pain. Also, you need to ask about the possibility of UTI, the signs and symptoms of UTI. And you will need to access her notes. Any lady, postpartum or post-surgical, post-operative, please don't forget in the history to ask for access to her notes. Here in this lady, you need to know more information about the delivery. If it was difficult, if it was prolonged, if there was any episiotomy or perineal lacerations or third or fourth degree perineal tears, if there was stitches and there is pain or hematoma at the site of the stitch, if there is any vaginal manipulations or vaginal bag which was inserted. Also, the type of anesthesia used is very important because urine retention may be a complication of regional anesthesia. What was the indication for the catheter? And was it removed before doing the forceps? Was it removed at the second stage of labor? And what was the time of removal after delivery? If there is any history of prolapse, because prolapse may lead to kinking of the urethra and may lead to retention, if the woman is freely mobile, if there is any associated comorbidities like nerve injuries, which may lead to urine retention by itself, if there is any drug allergy which may affect your way of management. Very important part and the new part which was added in the new talk article is to address the woman concern and to identify women at risk of urine retention. How to identify women at risk? Urine retention is not only inability to void urine. It's also there is suspicion that this woman may go into urine retention. How you assess the woman to identify if she's at risk for developing urine retention? Remember the abbreviation of VISI. VISI, V for volume, E for empty, S for sensation, S for stream, and I for incontinence. So V, volume, you will ask, did you pass a good volume of urine? E for empty, do you feel that your bladder is empty at the end? S for sensation, do you have a sensation that you still want to pass urine after voiding? S for stream, was your stream normal or abnormal? And I for incontinence, was there any incontinence? According to this, you can identify women who are at risk of developing urine retention. So this is the first part of the additional information you need to know, information from the history. From the examination, again, please be organized. Examination means general examination, abdominal examination, and pelvic examination. So presence of chaperone. And after patient consent, you need from the general examination to know about the vital signs and if there is any possibility of dehydration. Abdominal examination for palpable bladder and vaginal examination or genital examination for any traumas or swellings like hematomas if there are any possibility of leaks, prolapse, or missed vaginal swabs. In the investigation, of course, in any case, you will do urine, general, and culture plus ultrasound scan to measure the amount of post-void residual urine. So be organized. Can you give me a summary about the case? Go through the steps of the SPAR form, situation, background, assessment, and recommendation. And in the part of assessment, you can add the additional information you need to know about the patient. What are the additional information? Information from the history, from the examination, and from the investigation. So this will be the question of the first, the answer of the first question. Next, what will be your immediate action? This is an emergency situation. This lady needs immediate management. So what you need to know after taking relevant information from the patient, which was already done now, you will relieve her retention by inserting or reinserting a catheter. And I will measure the amount of drained urine because this will affect my next step of management. And I will inform my consultant. So these are the immediate actions if you have a case of postpartum urine retention. Information, reinserting the catheter, measure the amount of drained urine, and inform the consultant. What type of catheter you are going to use initially? Are going to use in and out catheter, Nilotin catheter, drain the urine, and use the smallest suitable size of the catheter. The second part, if you are going to use a catheter for longer time, you will use an indwelling catheter if the amount of voided urine is between 250 and 700. I'm so sorry, this will be 700. Indwelling catheter, if you, the amount of voided urine will be between 250 and 700 ml for 24 hours, and of course, use the aseptic techniques to prevent the possibility of infection. What's your diagnosis and what's the definition of postpartum urine retention? What do we mean by postpartum urine retention? Postpartum urine retention means inability or failure to pass urine within 6 hours of vaginal delivery or catheter removal. So 6 hours from the time of vaginal delivery or 6 hours from catheter removal. This condition should be recognized and treated early. The incidence, let's make our life easier. Let's say it's from 14 to 24% after a childbirth, and this will depend on the type of delivery. So failure to pass urine within 6 hours of delivery or catheter removal, and the incidence is 14 to 24%. There are two types of urine retention. Either it's overt urine retention or it is covert urine retention. What is overt urine retention? It means inability to void. There is no voiding at all. There is no spontaneous micturation or spontaneous voiding within 6 hours. 6 hours from vaginal delivery or 6 hours from the removal of the catheter, either after vaginal or after cesarean birth. So 6 hours after vaginal delivery without catheter, or 6 hours after vaginal delivery with catheter, or after cesarean section. The second type of urine retention is covert postpartum urine retention, which means there is spontaneous micturation, but the amount of residual urine is 150 ml or more. And this will be confirmed by ultrasound or by catheterization. So we have two types of urine retention, either overt or covert. Overt means the lady, she did not pass at all within 6 hours after vaginal delivery or after removal of the catheter. Covert means she passed urine, but the amount of post void residual urine is 150 ml or more, and this will be measured by the ultrasound or by catheterization. What are the causes and risk factors of postpartum urine retention? There are general causes and there are specific causes in this lady. In this lady, if we remember from the history, she's prima gravida. She delivered a large baby. and she had forceps delivery and she was in epidural. So there are four risk factors in this lady. What are the general risk factors or the additional risk factors? Primary porous woman, prolonged labor, if there is instrumental delivery, if there is previous history of postpartum urine retention, if she has history of recurrent UTI, if there is episiotomy and perineal tears with severe pain, if there is underactive bladder, if there was epidural anesthesia, if there is any possibility of hematomas, if large bags are inserted inside the vagina, if the patient is dehydrated, and sometimes this will be a physiological change due to increased progesterone level. So these are the general causes or the general risk factors of postpartum urine retention. To be specific in this lady is primary porous. She may have prolonged labor because of the large baby. She delivered by instrumental delivery and she was on epidural. And of course, she had an episiotomy or perineal tears. So these are the specific risk factors related to our task. And in general, these are the causes and the risk factors of postpartum urine retention. How to manage a case of postpartum urine retention? In the previous TOG article, it was depending on 500 and 150 ml. So forget about this one. And now we are going to discuss the new diagram or the new flow chart for managing postpartum urine retention. So any lady postpartum, she's not allowed to be kept without passing urine for more than 6 hours. So encourage the woman to void within 4 hours, or you can add 2 hours. So totally not more than 6 hours. Then ask the woman to void and document the voided volume. Here we have two scenarios. Either the woman is unable to void at all or she voided. So let's take the easiest scenario first, the less complicated scenario. The woman means less complicated in the scenario, not the complication itself. So the woman is unable to void. So 6 hours after delivery or 6 hours after removal of the catheter, she's not able to void at all. So at this stage, what are we going to do? We mentioned before, we will put in and out urinary catheter and we'll measure the amount of urine. If it is less than 150 ml, so we will consider other causes of reduced urine output. For example, like dehydration. So if the amount is less than 150, so we will consider other causes of reduced urine output. But if the amount is between 150 and 250 ml, means we need to do another attempt, second trial of voiding, and this second trial will be 6 hours later. So if the amount is 150, 250, we'll give a second trial for voiding 6 hours later after catheter removal. If the amount is between 250 and 700, we will keep the catheter for 24 hours and then we will try after 24 hours trial of voiding without catheter. If the amount is more than 700 ml, you will keep the catheter for 2 weeks and the patient can go home with the catheter. So this is the easy scenario. The easy scenario, the patient 6 hours after delivery or after removal of the catheter is unable to void. We will put in and out catheter. If the amount is less than 150 ml, we will consider other causes of reduced urine output. If the amount 150 to 250, we will again measure the amount of residual urine or post-void urine after 6 hours. If the amount 250 to 700, we will keep the catheter for 24 hours. After 24 hours, we will try voiding without a catheter. If more than 700, at this point, you will keep the catheter for 2 weeks and the woman will go home with the catheter and come back after 2 weeks. The second scenario, the woman voided, but the VESI questions suggesting that the woman has retention. Do you remember VESI? VESI means the volume, the bladder emptying, the sensation, the stream and the incontinence. If you have any suspicion or VESI suggests that there is possibility that this woman at risk of retention, yes or no? If yes, if you are suspecting or in this woman may have urine retention, so measure the amount of residual urine. Put in and out catheter. If it is less than 250 ml, the amount here is different. So if less than 250 ml, so proceed for a second trial or a second void, which will be 6 hours after removal of the catheter. This is if less than 250. Again, 250 to 700, we'll keep the catheter for 24 hours. After 24 hours, we'll do a trial without a catheter. Trial without a catheter after 24 hours. If the amount is more than 700 ml, so the patient will go home with the catheter and she will come back after 2 weeks. This, if the VESI suggests that there is possibility of retention. If no suspicion of retention, you will do a second void after 6 hours by in and out catheter. And if the amount is more than 700 ml, the patient will go home for 2 weeks with the catheter. If the amount here from 150 to 700, so we will insert the catheter for 24 hours. And after 24 hours, we will try without a catheter again. If the amount is less than 150, so this is a successful trial without a catheter. So again, how you are going to manage a case of postpartum urine retention according to the new guidelines in the TOG article, this will depend on the woman is unable to void at all or she is voiding. If she's unable to void, we'll insert a catheter and measure the residual volume, and according to the amount, we will deal. Just put it as a fixed point in your mind. If the amount between 250 to 700 ml, you will keep the catheter for 24 hours and you will do a trial without a catheter after 24 hours. If it is more than 700 ml, means you will let the patient go home with the catheter for 2 weeks. After 2 weeks, if still she has a problem, here we are going to ask the urologist to see her. The next point, what or whom you are going to involve in her management, whom you are going to involve in the management of this case. Of course, the consultant and the obstetrician. But if from the history, this woman was in epidural analgesia, what are you going to do? Whom you are going to involve? This is a very important question. The woman is in epidural anesthesia. So see from the history and red flags, if you have a possibility of anesthetic complication or the history and the examination are convincing that there is an obstetric cause like hematoma or severe stitches pain or vaginal bag. So if you have a suspicion of anesthetic complication, first you will involve the anesthetist and you will involve the radiologist to arrange for urgent MRI of the spine. So anesthetist and radiologist. According to the result of MRI, if the MRI shows there is anesthetic complication like hematoma, you will ask for urgent review by the spinal surgery team. If there is no suspicion or the MRI is negative, here the patient will be reviewed by the obstetrician. So till now, who's included in the management? The obstetrician, the anesthetist, the radiologist, and the spinal surgery team. If MRI is negative, or you are suspecting that the reason is obstetric cause, and the symptoms are mild or improving, reassure the lady that's likely to recover rapidly and just offer her follow-up. But if the symptoms are still severe or persistent, you refer her to the neurologist. So if you are asked in the exam whom you are going to involve in her management, this will be a multidisciplinary team, especially if she's an epidural, including the consultant obstetrician, the anesthetist, the radiologist for MRI, the spinal surgery team if she has anesthetic complication, the neurologist if she has persistent symptoms and severe symptoms with negative MRI, and of course you will involve the urologist if she's still having symptoms of retention after 2 weeks when the amount was more than 700 and the patient went home with the catheter. The next question will be how to reduce the morbidity postpartum voiding difficulty. How to reduce the morbidity? Anticipate the risk factor. Early anticipation, prevent complication. Early diagnosis. So how to diagnose? By documentation of the intra and postpartum void of urine. Then please remove the catheter in the second stage of labor and before using any instrument. If the catheter was not was needed, please don't remove the catheter until the patient is fully mobile. She can ambulate. And no woman is allowed to go more than 6 hours without voiding. So these are the points how to reduce the morbidity from postpartum voiding dysfunction. Early anticipation of risk factors, early diagnosis and management, remove the catheter in the second stage of labor and before instrumental delivery. If the catheter is needed, don't remove it before the patient is fully ambulated and no woman is allowed to go far than 6 hours without voiding. If suspected, if you suspect by the VESI questions, the volume again, the emptying of the bladder, the stream and the sensation and incontinence, give the woman appropriate analgesia, especially if she has pain, perineal pain at the stitch site, avoid constipation, and help the woman to walk to the toilet. So how to reduce morbidity? First, prevention. Then if you suspected that there is a risk or possibility, give appropriate analgesia, avoid constipation, and help the woman to ambulate. The next question, what you will do if you find hematoma after evacuation? You are suspecting after evacuation of the urine or draining the urine, the cause was diagnosed to be vaginal hematoma. This is an emergency situation. So in any emergency situation, remember communication, resuscitation, investigation and monitoring, and the definitive treatment. Communication, whom you want to communicate, will communicate with the patient, explain the diagnosis of the patient, be honest, duty of candor, then take a consent. The consent for examination under anesthesia and possible evacuation and hemostasis, and inform your consultant. So the communication points that you will be evaluated here will be communication of the patient, communication with the patient, communication with your consultant, and taking consent, which will be a point of safety. You will give the woman antibiotics cover. You will do the evacuation under cover of antibiotic after excluding the drug allergy. Then you will evacuate the collected blood and you will do proper hemostasis. Then you will keep a urinary catheter and vaginal bag for at least 24 hours after evacuation of the hematoma. You will do VTE risk assessment. And then remember the remaining points of the 7 Ds. As I told you before, any patient with complication, post-operative or postpartum, remember the clinical governance issues. This patient needs documentation, proper documentation, debriefing of the patient, the family, and the staff, duty of candor, be honest to the patient and say sorry. Then incidents reporting to avoid this happening in the future if there was anything that can be avoided. Now the last question will be, what are the possible implications and the possible symptoms that the lady is likely to suffer in the future? Try to be different. Don't go immediately and mention the possible complication. Be reassuring. Always when you are mentioning any risk or any complication, be reassuring. Give the positive and the negative. So say, postpartum urine retention, if managed promptly and if managed properly, most patients will have normal bladder function on discharge. But there are possible complications in the future if it was not managed properly, like recurrent UTI, bilionephritis. This lady may have voiding difficulties in the future, like hesitancy, dribbling, and straining. She may have chronic retention with overflow incontinence. She may have affection of her kidney function. And if ignored, it may lead to painless urinary retention and potentially lifelong catheterization. So this is the way to to answer all the possible questions in this task. Again, as I told you in the beginning, lead the discussion, please. If you know the steps of the management, go step by step. Don't wait for the examiner to make it like a question and answer. You have a case of postpartum urine retention. You know how to deal it, how to deal with it. So lead the discussion. I hope this was beneficial for you. I hope that you are still doing your hard work to pass in this exam. Again, the last point, be organized. If you go organized, you will not miss any point, you will not miss any mark, and it will be a very easy exam or piece of cake exam. Wish you the best of luck. Please, if you find it useful, remember me in your prayers, remember me and my family in your prayers, and share it with your friends. Thank you so much, and see you in another task. Wassalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.